And all this leads us to Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade. Now, Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade has actually, over time, become my favorite Indiana Jones movie. When I was younger, I always thought Raiders of the Lost Ark was the must-see movie. Every time I had the option of like one, two, or three, I'd always pick Raiders. But for some reason, as I've gotten older, and I don't know, maybe it's the father-son relationship aspect of the film, maybe it's just that I enjoy the humor in it a little bit more. Or maybe it's just the fact that I think it has the best action sequences of all three films. But I certainly consider The Last Crusade to be my personal favorite Indiana Jones film. It's probably a close call for a lot of people between this one and Raiders. As for the movie itself, it's actually the only Indiana Jones film that I know of where he is very reluctant on going on the adventure. In fact, he goes on the adventure not so much because he wants to find the Holy Grail as much as he wants to find his father. And it's his father who's more interested in finding the Holy Grail than he is. Naturally, you've got that father-son aspect of the film. You've got, of course, the Nazis come back as the main villains because, everyone hates Nazis, except maybe Nazis. Before I jump into the special features, I wanted to finish my plot synopsis real quick. I just wanted to also bring up that I'm really happy that the Saul character comes back in this film, John Rhys Davis's character. And there's a pretty decent amount of action sequences, and I really just all around actually think that this has some of the better comedic acting as well as serious acting of all three films. And I just, again, I really appreciate the relationship between Sean Connery and Harrison Ford. I feel like they had actually really good chemistry together. Even though there's that old joke of, like, in order for Sean Connery to have had Indiana Jones, he would have had to have fathered him at, like, the age of 10 or so. Which we all know he probably could have done, because Sean Connery was never young. He was always a ladies' man. But let's jump into the special features right quick. You got another introduction, so I really shouldn't jump into that too much, since it's basically, again, it's just Spielberg and Lucas discussing their love affair for these films. My favorite actual special feature of all three discs is Indiana Jones' Women, which is the Film Institute's tribute to the three leading ladies of the film, and it's fun listening to the three actresses discuss their role and what it was like making the movies. You also have an Indy's Friends and Enemy featurette, which just goes through all of his allies and his enemies throughout the course of the trilogy. Or I guess it's a quadrilogy now, isn't it? The storyboard of the opening sequence you get. I would have much rather have preferred to get a storyboarding of the sequence in which Indy and his father escape from the Zeppelin, and they have that little dogfight sequence. Which, of course, if you remember in the movie, Sean Connery accidentally shoots the tail wing off of the plane, and they end up crash landing, and they end up stealing a vehicle, and it ends with Sean Connery pulling out his umbrella and scaring a bunch of seagulls in order to wreck the last fighter pilot plane. That's the storyboard sequence I actually really wanted to see, not necessarily this opening sequence, but for some reason, I guess the filmmakers decided that this was more entertaining and more interesting to watch, which it is. I mean, like I said, I'm a big fan of watching how storyboards become film. Not just because I'm interested in filmmaking myself, I think it's just a really neat process. And of course, now they have animatics, so you don't even get storyboards like this anymore. But let's see here, let's move on to again, you get another gallery, and then, of course, another Lego demo game. Don't necessarily have to talk about either of those, I think. All in all, you get about another hour's worth of special features. Not too shabby. I also kind of thought it was kind of interesting. This was the only one of the Indiana Jones films that's rated PG-13, and I know it's mostly because the PG-13 rating didn't exist when they made Temple of Doom or Raiders, but I seriously don't feel like this is a PG-13 movie. Like, of all the Indiana Jones films, this one to me is probably the least violent and the least graphic and probably the most deserving of being just PG. I thought that was kind of interesting and silly. Just one of those little things you notice when you buy the movies and you're like, PG-13, what? Well worth the $20 that I spent on this one as well. Like I said, all in all, I got my money's worth out of this one. I've watched all three of these movies multiple times, as well as the special features. I think if you add it all up, there's probably about 3 hours worth of special features in this box set, which certainly nothing compared to like The Lord of the Rings, which has like 18 hours worth of special features on them. If you combined all three of the special editions together, I think there's a good 18 hours worth of special features. So, nothing like that, but obviously I didn't spend as much money on this one either. And I got a pretty good kick out of getting the free movie ticket to the Crystal Skull, and I suppose I should probably tell you guys what my thoughts were on the Crystal Skull right quick, right? I'm sure you're interested. I didn't hate the movie. I didn't particularly like the movie. I felt like there were things about the film that were obviously flawed. I think the biggest problem with the Crystal Skull was, and I know people have said this a lot, but I think it has to do mainly with the believability factor. Because if you look at Raiders of the Lost Ark, there's nothing really supernatural that happens in that movie until the very end, when they open the Ark. Other than that, the movie really doesn't have any major special supernatural moments in it. In fact, Indiana Jones even states at the beginning of that film that he doesn't believe in a bunch of superstitious mumble jumble. Which I thought was really great, and it builds up to that sequence so that once you get to that miraculous moment, you're more invested in it. It's easier to swallow and easier to believe. And it's the same with The Last Crusade. In The Last Crusade, nothing majorly supernatural happens until the very end when they get to the Ark, or not the Ark, but the cup, the Holy Grail. Temple of Doom, obviously, I think it's a little bit more supernatural, but even that, like the major, only real major supernatural moment in that film is, of course, the chest ripping out sequence, and the beating heart, and the guy going into the lava, which even that's kind of like, people really used to do that stuff, so I don't think they would have still been alive, but people did used to ritually sacrifice people by ripping their hearts out. It's a fun little thing to think about. Whereas in Kingdom of the Crystal Skull, the movie opens with that whole sequence with the nuclear bomb test and Indy hiding in the refrigerator, right? I'm pretty sure it was a fridge. I might be wrong. I haven't seen that movie since I watched it in theaters, so you're gonna have to forgive me if I don't get everything right. And of course, you get the big and the fridge flies like a fucking million feet in the air and crash lands in the desert, and he gets out, and all he is a little bit cold. And then from there, what you have the three waterfall sequence as well. That moment when Shia LaBeouf uses his psychic ability to communicate with the monkeys. It's just stupid, I guess. Of course, all this leads to them in the alien spacecraft with the interdimensional beings. So, yeah, I'd say the biggest problem with Kingdom of the Crystal Skull was just by that point, there's no real tension because you know Indy's gonna make it. Yeah, whereas with like Raiders and even The Last Crusade, there's no real guarantee that either Indiana Jones or his father are gonna make it out. And I think that's the biggest flaw with Crystal Skull is that, like I said, there's just no tension. And it's like I said, it's the one Indiana Jones film I don't care that I don't own. I mean, I like Temple of Doom a hell of a lot more than I liked Kingdom of the Crystal Skull. But that's pretty much my review of the DVD box set of Indiana Jones. I would say it was well worth the $20. I'm sure that now, it's been about 2 years, you could probably find it for even cheaper than that. I bought it at Best Buy when I got it. I'm sure if you go to like Walmart, you could probably find it for 10, $15, probably about the same price that I got The Karate Kid for. And like I said, it's well worth it. It's basically $10 for Raiders, $10 for Last Crusade, and you can get Temple of Doom for free, which is a pretty cool deal. So, If you want it, go get it. If you already got it, I hope you enjoy it. And if you don't like the Indiana Jones films, what the hell's wrong with you? You have no soul. But until next time, this has been Benjamin. I wish you guys all the best of luck.